Good morning, y'all having a good morning so far? Everyone? All right. So I like to start off saying nice things to each other. So you can look at someone around you and just say, you're gifted by God. They don't have to be near you. Just look at them. Anybody. Just say, you're gifted by God. And now that we've cheered each other up a little bit, this message today, I have actually, like, could have easily been a three-part series, honestly. And I was going to preach on something completely different, and then God just kept dropping this in my heart. And so I changed it over, and then I went crazy with it. And then I had to condense it. And so bear with me. It's not a 20-minute, 25, but somewhere around 30-something. But it's not a light or fluffy topic. I pray that it's something that can really empower and impact us as a church, bringing us closer together. So I hope it's worth it, and I pray. I just know that this is something God's put on my heart to speak about. And if anybody knows me, I am, like, I like to harass my friends and family and coworkers and pastors, everyone pretty much that's close to me, about their personality types and making, you know, I want to know, like, how they work and how I can best, like, communicate with them. Not just personality types, but also spiritual gifts. Like, how has God wired you? What is it about you that helps us to work together so well, that could help us to work together so well? Well, one thing that I noticed coming into the Salvation Army is that we have a group of people that absolutely love to serve the Lord. We have a group of people that are on fire, like, just anytime there's something that needs to be done, you know, anytime someone is going through anything, people show up and we gather around each other. We form this body of unity. And it's a very Christ-like characteristic to show up for one another. Last time I was preaching behind this pulpit, I had the honor to speak on those characteristics of Jesus. And it was just a reminder that as Jesus is, as Christ means anointed one, we are his Christians, his little anointed ones, and our goal is to be more like Christ every day. Now, the one thing that Jesus left us with, though he's not physically sitting in a pew right now, he has successfully left us with a beautiful thing, a beautiful part of himself, that is the Holy Spirit. And with the Holy Spirit come various gifts. So if you know, with those gifts, we are as a body, those gifts helps us to join together as a body. And another thing I've noticed coming into the Salvation Army when it comes to that specific area is that, you know, there seems to be sometimes there's just mixed feelings when it comes to the teaching of spiritual gifts. Sometimes there's confusion. And that's just not here. That's a lot of places. And there are, like, some people that may operate in their gifts and within the army. There are some people that are, like, kind of scared, like, I don't want to touch that. I don't want to think about it. And there's some people that are just, like, hostile, you know, and they're just like, don't talk to me about this at all. And I get it, because there are a variety of theological teachings out there that don't always agree with each other. For example, there are opposing groups of theologists in the body of Christ known as cessationists, and then there's the continuationists. I know those are pretty big words, but cessationists basically just believe that the signs and gifts, the sign gifts like prophecy, tongues, miracles, healing, they have all ceased in some sense. And then you have on the other spectrum continuationism, and they believe that that those gifts continue through today. And then you have those in, like, the persecuted, underprivileged nations that they don't know about these arguments at all, and they just get saved and they go out and they whatever is needed to make disciples, they do it. Like, whatever the Holy Spirit empowers them to do, they just go for it. And because of that, you see that there are lots of like just signs and wonders following them. There are miracles following them, and their only hope is to not end up dead or in prison, right? And so their churches are growing by the thousands, even millions underground in such rough climates. And I confess, a part of my testimony is that, and one of the reasons I joined the Salvation Army is because I want that type of lifestyle. I want to be able to go out and reach the lost, the people who are the least, the last, and the lost, people who are overlooked by society. I want to be able to present what God has and be a miracle in their life. And being to those nations, those rough, and encountering those rough situations and those people that are on fire and using their gifts for God has changed me and has pushed me into this direction. So I've seen those people. I've lived amongst them. I've been one of those wide-eyed, eager college students praying for people in the streets of America and witnessing healings and miracles. And so much that if I were to apply to the cessationist group now, I wouldn't qualify. They would kick me out. Like, no, you got to go. But at the same time, I understand. I can see how on the opposite spectrum, there are parts of the continuationist group in North America specifically that could pervert, that have perverted these gifts and titles and used it for their own selfish gain. And that creates confusion, that creates distrust and division in the church, and it hurts. It hurts us, and hurts my heart because people there are hurting. There are people all around us, all around the church that are hurting on the outside of this confusion, waiting for a miracle, a kind, selfless person with a meal or maybe a word from God. They're waiting for you and I. And so as we briefly overview today each of the gifts, briefly overview each category of gifts, I strongly encourage you to take every thought or feeling that comes to the surface directly to the Lord and ask him to do with it what he will. Keep it, discard it, put it on the shelf for studies later. Whatever it is, that's between you and God. My responsibility and desire today is to just discuss what I see in scripture, what I've experienced in other parts of the world, the world church, and to be true and repeat what I feel the Holy Spirit saying to this church. So let's turn together to the passage titled Spiritual Gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. Paul starts off saying, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit." Now, in context, several passages before this passage, in chapter 11, Paul is basically laying out order, addressing confusion in the church in different areas. And this one, he continues, but he's talking specifically about this form of spiritual gifts. And one of the things that can be confusing about the gifts is that there are three different letters that Paul wrote to three different churches, and Paul actually makes three different lists of gifts, very similar in some ways, but different. Now, either Paul was getting senile and he just forgot what he said to certain, I forgot what I said to the Ephesians, but y'all do this. Or he was strategically listing what was needed to be heard in that specific church, clearing up the confusion. I like the latter. I'm going to go with that. So what he says next helps us to see the difference between the three lists following in the following verses here. So let's look at 4-6. He says, "There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. there are diversities of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but the same God who works all in all. So here we see kind of like a chart layout. We see the category of three different gifts. Who are these gifts are given by and represented by, and what those gifts are. So we see in 1 Corinthians the gifts of the Spirit, Ephesians 4, and if you were to turn with me there, we will see ministries from Christ, where Paul specifically says, Jesus has given me, Jesus has given us and left us with these ministries, these gifts, for the purpose of edifying and empowering the church. And then we have in Romans 12, 6 through 8, specific list of gifts that Paul says are activities from God. He says specifically that from God gave to each one his measure of faith. And he goes down to list these things. So we're going to start with, I know it's a little backwards on up there, but that's a Lexi thing. but we'll start with Romans 12, 6 through 8. So let's go there together. And while we don't have time to like run through, like describe in detail every single gift that's on there, do want to help to see what they are, what their functions are, and how we operate with them as a body of Christ. Okay? So with the Romans 12, 6 through 8, we have prophecy, ministry, or service. Different translations may say service or helps, administration sometimes. Then we have teaching, exhortation, or the gift of encouragement, giving, leading, and mercy. Now, these are known as activities. Like, these are the gifts that God gives every single person at birth. And how do we know this? Like, well, if you look around, you can meet any person, whether they are believers or not, and they are operating in some form of, like, their gifts and their talents come from these seven things specifically. They are operating in that somewhere. So you can have people with a teaching gift that are not believers. You can have people encouraging, running around encouraging people, and it's just natural for them. Prophecy, you may look at that like, but then you think about fortune tellers. Just because they're not using it for God doesn't mean they're not, that's not something that God's blessed them with. But it looks different when you are serving the enemy. These gifts may look different than when you're serving God. Instead of using it to build people and push them closer to God, some people will use these gifts for their own selfish gain. But if you were to have this set of gifts in Romans 12, 6 through 8, here's what it might look like, let's say, Salvation Army style, at a potluck. Let's say you got seven people sitting at a table at a potluck, and one person walks by and they're carrying everything like this, and then they spill their drink all over the table with those seven people sitting there. If those seven people represented these seven gifts, one per person, then the person gifted in prophecy would have like, saw that coming. Should have told you. I should have told you that was going to happen. Then you would have been more careful, you know. But their motivation is to warn and convict people of their sin, what they did wrong, right? Person operating in the gift of ministry or service or helps would say, I'll help you clean it up. She has the desire to meet that practical need. The teacher in the group would say, the reason that tray fell is that you put too many things on this side and you needed to balance the weight and be more careful, right? I saw y'all looking at people. And the crew. There are a lot of teachers here at Salvation Army, at Flint Citadel anyway. Exhortation. the person operating with that gift of encouragement will say, it's okay, things happen, and you've done a great job tonight. You know, you've done a great job with everything else. But next time next time somebody can help you carry your drinks to the next table. And she gives an encouraging word and a practical solution to the problem so it doesn't happen again. I got a little bit of a soapbox. 2 seconds. As ministry leaders, we get a lot of emails correcting things that we've done, and they're welcomed. Things that we may have done wrong, it could be corrected, it's form of correction, and that's totally fine. But you have no idea how much just one encouraging email would boost us and just like send us into like, I don't know, Jesus land, whatever. But it's this is an amazing gift, and if you know that you operate in that, don't hold it back. You know, if you see anybody, not just the ministry leaders, but sound booth, if you recognize anything that they're doing and you're appreciative of it, let them know. Because the teachers will let us know, you know, what things need to be corrected, and it's good to have a good balance of that, you know. So back to the little scenario, giving, the person who has the gift of giving will say, oh, you know what, it's okay, I'll buy you a new drink, here, take mine. And he uses his personal assets to meet a practical need. The person operating with mercy would say, will respond by hugging the host or that person, whoever spilled the drink, and saying, oh, it's okay, don't feel bad. It could have happened to anybody. And the person that is the leader, operating in leadership in that, will respond to the spilled dessert by saying, Bob, would you get some towels to wipe up the table? Mary, grab the mop for the floor. And Jane, help me fix some more drinks for everybody at the table. And that is the gift of leading. And does anybody in this room see yourself in any of these categories? I know I could, like, every time I read one of these, I could just picture certain faces in our church, certain people who've, we've had those encounters. It's beautiful. We need that. We need that variety. So think about it. Which one of these are you? At the end of the service, there's cards on the altars here and holiness table that have the three categories of list, and there'll be an opportunity for you to respond and share, whether you know or maybe you're like, I don't know what my gifts are, to share it with us so we can come along and help and walk beside you in that, and help to empower you in your purpose. So along with that first list of activities from God, when Jesus came, he died and he left the Holy Spirit, but he also left us these forms of gifts that are people. And you see that it says apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. These are the differences of ministry, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12, but the same Lord. So in Ephesians 4:11, we see each of these gifts, and some of them in this category, there are some controversial or like mixed feelings of some of these within the church as well. For example, the top two, like no one ever really picks on evangelists or pastors or teachers, you know, like that's kind of self-explanatory in what their roles are. But like when it comes to apostles and prophets, there's a lot of discussion between that and some confusion, because we're like, well, if someone's, you know, maybe someone in the, on, you know, two opposing sides would say, well, apostles can know, like, if someone calls himself an apostle, can they rewrite scripture? Can they do this? You're like, can they add to scripture or whatever? And then over here we have people saying, you know, that may be on the completely opposite side, like, I am apostle so-and-so, and I am going to write and inspire scripture and all that, you know. And then you have these people on the opposite sides, and I believe Jesus is somewhere in, like, in the middle, No, not saying that people, new apostles can write anything new, but also that we're not supposed to despise them. So we're not taking, we're not, if someone operates in this role of apostleship, they're not taking, they're not forming the church all over again. We don't need to do that. The church is established, it's built. But then there are specific things that the apostles are meant to do, like go out. Like these are the missionaries. These are the church planners. They go out and they build on, they go out into places that are desolate, that are torn down, and they build up the body of Christ there. They make leaders. These are the leaders of leaders. These are the ministry starters in different areas and places where people are not hearing the gospel. They will live amongst the people for a period of time to build them up, to build the leaderships up, edify them, and then go off into the next journey. This is what Paul, what we see the apostles doing, right? So it's a role. It's a role. It's a kind of a lifestyle, but it doesn't take on the same role that the first original apostles did. So we should neither despise it nor try to turn it into something of our own. And then those who operate as prophets would be those who are not, it's the same story kind of, like prophets are not walking around nowadays with a scroll saying, "Thus saith the Lord," but prophets may operate in a way of saying, like, "Hey, I just, the Lord," and just going up to someone one-on-one, personally, and just saying, "Hey, I really felt like in prayer God was telling me that you're struggling with this specific thing, or I had a dream about you that you went through this. Is this true? Can I pray with you?" And that person's like, "Well, thank God, I've been asking for, you know, for anything for him to show me," and it edifies and it builds that person up. And sometimes it can look in the form of, you know, going to someone and saying, "Hey, the Lord made me aware that you have this ongoing thing in your life that has to, like, that's holding you back from your purpose, whether it's sin, whether it's whatever, lifestyle," and have that personal conversation with someone. And that's a gift of prophecy, like how a prophet would operate within a church setting, within a family nowadays, not recreating scripture, or and it's a very humble way, and these people are also needing to be held accountable by the word of God and open to people coming and challenging what they're saying. Not just like, "Well, God said it, so don't talk to me." No, it's like, okay, let's take it to the word of God. Does it line up with what the scripture already says? All right, cool, let's go. And so then those are just two areas, specifically evangelists. Think of Billy Graham, just gifted with the gospel to take it across to any group of person, like any type of person whatsoever. Be able to relationally and bring the gospel to them. And then you have pastors who are like shepherds and teachers who are pretty much very accurate-minded and wanting us to be, all of us to be accurate and wanting to teach us the best way through scripture and are in love with the word of God, right? So it's just like if you, for example, like we have, sorry, I forgot to add this example in there for apostles, but one of the most prevalent forms of apostleship I see right now is officership. What I'm seeing is that this group of, you know, these people have completely given their lives to go to some foreign city, some state, wherever they're being assigned, and building up, going into that community, using their gifts to build up that community, and then off to the next assignment eventually. And so, it's just one of those things, like I see with, for example, the Hellstroms. They have raised many, many leaders and brought many disciples to Christ. They've enrolled over 170 senior soldiers and have helped 26 people become officers, become the next ministry leaders. So they're operating in that fuller purpose, that full calling of not just helping to do all the administrative things, but building up the people to go. So Paul goes on to say that the people called to these offices are meant to edify and build up the rest of the body of Christ. Is everyone called to be in a ministry role? If so, who would run the rest of society? You know, who would be the doctors and the teachers and the police officers and everything else? So the way the church was operating is that these people served the church. They built up the church for the church to go out into their fields, into the community, and be a light and representative to them. So these are the roles that Jesus left as gifts for the church. So whether or not you feel called to one of these offices, only the Lord can reveal that to you. Others may be able to confirm what the Lord is saying, but only God can point you, can put that calling on your life. And as a cherry on top of all of these three sets of gifts, God gave us an innate set of gifts when we were born. And then Jesus, when he came, he left these five gifts that are people for us to edify us. But then he sent the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit adds on this very distinct set of gifts that you don't see everywhere else. You don't see unbelievers operating in these because they are specifically through the Holy Spirit. Like Paul said, nobody can claim the Holy Spirit unless through the Holy Spirit, unless they have the Holy Spirit. So these are distinct for the church, for the body of Christ, to set ourselves apart out there and to even the ease of making disciples, for the ease of going out and saying, like, hey, like, let me show you who my God is. Let me show you who we're working with. And let me show you how much he loves you, most importantly. It is not to be a flashy show or anything. It's to say, we're about business. God wants you. He wants all of us. We need to be able to use these gifts in order to pull some people who are far on the opposite, far away from God. And a lot of times these gifts help to do that. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, works of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, various tongues, interpretation of tongues. Definitely do not have time to go through all of these, but there are lots of descriptions out there, to look up, okay, what do these look like? And there is also prayer, asking the Holy Spirit, like, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to operate with? Like, which of these gifts are what you offer me? Because only God can. Only the Holy Spirit can choose these for you. So why is it important that we know these different lists of gifts, that we understand what they look like? Paul gives several reasons, and we'll go back to 1 Corinthians 12:12 and read down. As Lane read earlier, it says, for as the body is one and has many members, but all the bodies of that body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. And then we have Ephesians 4:12, where he explains, after listing the gifts of the ministries, he says, for the equipping of the saints, so Jesus gave these ministries for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, until we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we shall no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. So how many of you think that the entire church, not just our church, but the whole body of Christ is united in one faith, in one thought process? Anybody? No. Like, everybody knows, even unbelievers know, that there are multiple divisions still amongst the church. So we are not there yet. But if the enemy were to do anything, he would confuse us and stop us from being able to do this, being able to equip. He would hinder those who are operating in these gifts through confusion theologies and all kinds of mixed, thought lines. So overall, why do we need to know? Why is it important for us to use our gifts? Because we need to help others. Like, others need us. We are each other's others. And there are others outside of these walls that desperately need the Lord. Whether they know it or not, they may scream at you, hate you, whatever. But at the end, if they were to actually give their life to Christ because of you, there is a party in heaven. And it doesn't stop there. They make more disciples because of us, right? Lives are changed for the glory of God. And it's for the edifying of the body of Christ. In Proverbs 29:18, God says that where there's no vision, my people perish. Our body suffers when the other parts of us are not in motion, or we've lost sight, lost vision. If we don't remember who, like how God, like we're some that, don't feel like we make a difference in the body and we're discouraged, or some that lost the vision of their purpose and have stopped operating in the calling because we're worn out or discouraged, forgotten, unseen, or just can't find a way to plug in. We need each other for that. And if not, spiritual boredom sets in. We turn away from a relationship, a vibrant relationship with Christ, and we turn to religion, just doing the rituals, the things that we got to do every week, right? And that's dangerous. It's dangerous for a church, and it ends up tearing us down as a church instead of building us up. People start to, when spiritual boredom set in, people can start to just nitpick on things and say like, oh, we, fix this and fix that and fix that or whatever, and instead of operating in their role. And then people feel more down than any before, but there's a role, there's a way that God has meant for us to operate as a body to bring life. So lastly, in conclusion, we need to know how. It's not enough to just talk about these gifts. It's not enough to read about them and just say, oh, those are nice. But to actually work, operate in them and get out of a place of spiritual boredom and get out of this lost feeling of like, what's my purpose? Like, I don't know. I'm just going to go to church. We need each other to be active in all of the areas. So the more we step out of our comfort zone and dive into things that may scare us a little, or seem a little inconvenient to our normal routine, the more God can develop us and use our gifts. That's outside of our comfort zone most times. The more we find ways to share the gospel, to make a difference in the lives of people who don't have everything they need, people who are in survival mode, people who feel stuck, the more we see a need to use our gifts. When we're in comfort, a lot of time when we're just like always day in and day out, just kind of like, I'm going to stay and keep to me and mine, we don't really see the need, and we become stagnant in a way. So when we go, how do we use our gifts? How do we use our gifts? When we go where the need is and are face to face with the people who are in need of these miracles, of these gifts, of these words from the Lord, the more opportunity the Holy Spirit has room to perform miracles through us, to perform life change through us. So this summer and next year, there will be an ample amount of opportunities for us to step out of our walls, to step out of our comfort zones. I promise we are not just trying to make more work for ourselves and for y'all, but by providing these opportunities, it's waking our church up. It's helping us to grow in our gifts and to grow in numbers, bringing in disciples. But So we need to step out outside of our comfort zone, go where the need is, be vessels for the Lord to empower through our gifts. And sometimes that looks like stepping out in faith, being in the right place at the right time for God to use you to make a difference in someone's life. Some of those ways can include, specifically at our core, Serve Day that's coming up. We've got sign-up boards back there. We'll have more details coming out about what each project looks like. One project for the blessing bag one, we are actually going into the most impoverished complex in Flint with the sheriff, the police department, the city of Flint, and 30 or 40 other resource companies in the city. And we'll have bounce houses and food truck, and everything's free for the kids. We might get the sheriff in the dunk tank, hopefully. I don't know. But, like, there's opportunity. There's a way to reach this, that community and say, like, hey, we're here for you. Like, people don't go into that complex because with survival mode, with poverty comes danger, comes people just trying to make their way and using violence to do it. So people usually, not even law enforcement, usually goes into that place by themselves. Like, they go in large groups. And so now is our opportunity to go as a large group, a large community, and let them know, like, hey, we are here for you. You don't have to stay in this way. You don't have to stay in this lifestyle. So that's an opportunity on Serve Day, as well as a few others. Don't want to hold you hostage any longer, so I'll just go through this list. Sharing, serving at... sharing, when I say sharing, it could be musically, it could be devotional, coming and sharing a word, testimony, whatever, at dinner church. Serving, helping to serve dinner, be a part of the setup and tear down crew. There's a lot of young teens there, lots of young teens that are just needing people to love on them, right? And not just teens, it's a pretty mixed crew there. Get trained to become an ESL teacher, which more information will come out with that. Ask about leading a small group, and ask about joining a serve team. That's what these opportunities are here for. So in my closing of my closing, it'd just be a moment of altar call of prayer. And there are three people.
West Kersley Street, Flint, Michigan.
Thank you. Forgot where I was, apparently. So there are three types of people in this room. There are those who are learning about the differences in gifts for the first time, those who have learned about the gifts but have never found a way to dive in and start applying the gifts within their community, within our community, your church and your family. They know about it but just haven't really activated. And then there are those who have learned, have been discipled into their gifts, and are now in a place where they can help disciple and walk others into their calling. As Christians, as Christ's little anointed ones, we are not done until we are dead. Or with the Lord is a better way of saying that, right? So let's take a moment, and there are cards, like I said, at either side of the room and in the center, and pens. Not asking you to sign your life in blood on anything, you know. We're just saying circle what you feel either God has already shown you what your gifts are, or what you take a moment and pray and ask God, Lord, how do you want to use me? What are the gifts that you think I have, you know, or that you have given me? And just circle what those are in those different categories, one or two of them. And take that moment to just commit it to the Lord. Put them in the offering buckets here, and we will collect them, and we will pray over them, and we will ask God, how can we help to empower everyone, each and every one that he's blessed us with here, okay? So let's take that moment. You can start whenever. He's going to play a little bit, but after a little while, after you're praying amongst yourselves and talking to God, then I'll close us out in prayer. ask you to bow your head and close your eyes with me as we pray out, pray a benediction. Feel free to continue to fill out cards if you haven't gotten to do that yet.